Did you know the iPad is 15 years old? Originally announced in January 2010 by Steve Jobs, it went on sale April 3rd the same year, but it's been pretty divisive. Is it a computer? Is it not? Has Apple held back the software? Should it just run macOS? But for me and a lot of other creators, the iPad has been key to several workflows, like editing video, podcasts, drawing, productivity, and more. So in this video, I'm going to share my top 20 iPad apps of all time and shows how the iPad, even with the current software, can really be a powerhouse. Now for my number one app, I have to give it to Ferrite. Ever since the 2018 iPad Pro and even before, I have edited my podcasts here on iPad. And Ferrite is an incredibly powerful app, both for getting high quality audio, but I can do MP3 chapters with custom chapter artwork, and the app takes care of it all for me. Not only that, but with the Apple Pencil and Ferrite, I can edit extremely fast, and it helps me get Primary Technology, that's my weekly tech podcast with Jason A10, link above and in the description, gets all edited and produced extremely fast. If you want to see an in-depth look of me editing a podcast on iPad, it's a little older, but this video right here does the trick. Number two, I have to give it to Lightroom. Lightroom from the Adobe Creative Suite is an incredibly powerful application, and it feels perfect for an iPad screen. Not only does the iPad Pro have some of the best displays Apple has ever made, now with the Tandem OLED, but editing with Apple Pencil, with masks and drawing, or if you're a photographer in the field, using the iPad just feels like the perfect form factor. Now number three, when there is a moment where I need to go back to my Mac, I use Screens 5 here on the iPad. You can connect to multiple Macs using Screens 5. It's super fast, intuitive using the touch interface, it's responsive, and even works with multiple displays, and means I can access my Macs anywhere in the world from my iPad. Now, another incredibly powerful app for iPad is Pixelmator. I use Pixelmator Pro all the time on my Mac for making things like thumbnails, and Pixelmator Pro actually brings a lot of that power to the iPad. I've done a lot of podcast and episode artwork here, plus you still have powerful tools like the repair tool in Pixelmator all right here on your tablet. Pixelmator also has great templates if you want to make images and grids for social media, and it's incredibly flexible whether you want to make print documents, digital, and more. By the way, if you're curious about this little folding case, that's actually today's video sponsor, MoFT. This is their dynamic folio for iPad, and it's honestly one of my favorite iPad accessories in a long time. So you can fold this many different ways. Again, one of my favorites is theater mode, which you can fold it back, and it uses magnets in the folio to keep everything together. Then when you're ready to watch something, you can just set it down. That's theater mode. Or maybe you're going to edit some podcast or use Lightroom on the iPad. Well, from theater mode, I can just bend the iPad back, and now I have an ultimate creation station right here. It's at an ideal height. This actually makes it great to edit podcasts with the Apple Pencil. And this is the lightest floating creativity station for iPad I've seen. And it has the magnets to put your iPad to sleep, uses magnets to stay attached to the back as well. Super thin, which makes it convenient to throw into a bag and take it when you're traveling. It even has a portrait reading mode where you can lift this little tab here, which is a magnet, slide the other half there, snaps closed. And now you can use it as a portrait reading device. Perfect if you're browsing the web or you just want to look at the show notes of the latest episode of your favorite podcast. You can also get the quick release Apple Pencil holder. It magnetically attaches here to the folio. Now you can place your iPad back, attach your Apple Pencil for charging, close it up, and you're ready to go with your Apple Pencil secured. And if you want to detach, it's just as easy to just take it off, and now you're back to just using the folio. Also, if you forget how to fold the folio, these little images and tabs here, there's little icons on the folio to remind you how you can connect it. You can also put it in dual screen mode, where now you have a place to put your iPhone. Maybe you want to take notes during a call or lecture, or you can put on a tutorial video up here while you work on your iPad. Super flexible, versatile, this is now my go-to case for iPad. Link to get the MoFT Dynamic Folio down in the video description, and my thanks to MoFT for sponsoring this video. Next, another great use case for iPad is dealing with PDFs or other digital documents and using the Apple Pencil for markup or filling out forms. While there's lots of apps that are great at this, I use Goodnotes. Not only is it powerful, it gives you lots of tools for drawing and markup, they even added some AI tools here where it can actually summarize text in a PDF. You can ask Goodnotes certain things here, almost like an AI prompt. And Goodnotes makes it easy to manage multiple pages of a PDF document, export with annotations or without. Highly recommend. Next up, and this is a fun one, Orion from the makers of Halide and Keynote. Orion lets you use the iPad to actually ingest or capture video from another source. I'm going to use this $10 video capture device. I'll put a link to this on Amazon in the video description. But then you can connect whatever you want here, a Nintendo Switch, any other video game system, or if you film a lot with your iPhone and you want to be able to preview the video on a larger screen, you can connect your iPhone HDMI out into the little video capture device and then into Orion, and now you actually get a mirror of the screen here in the Orion app. Powerful little app for doing fun things like this, or for just using this as a larger monitor or screen when you're on the go. Next, if you wanted to edit video on iPad, there are actually some powerful apps out there. Of course, you have to mention Final Cut Pro, which was recently updated. It's actually getting more and more powerful all the time. Multicam, effects, and Final Cut Camera with your iPhone and other Apple devices makes this really powerful. And an alternative is LumaFusion, which I know is used by creators like Fernando Silva at 9to5Mac. And he's edited, I think, all his videos on iPad with LumaFusion. So if you want to do video editing from your tablet, it's definitely doable. Number 8, this is a more recent app, and I love it for framing screenshots. This is Shareshot, and when you open the app, it automatically pulls the last screenshot you took, and you can reformat this, whether you want it 16:9, maybe square, and you can even go in and adjust the screenshot even further. You can choose from different gradient backgrounds, choose where you want the light to be coming from in the image, and it also supports shortcuts so you can make screenshots frame nicely super fast. I love Shareshot, and another app that was updated recently, and I use it for managing entertainment like TVs, movies, and books, is Sofa. The Sofa app is super fun. Not only do I use it to keep track, again, of movies that I want to watch or have watched, I can create smart lists where I could see family movies watched. I also keep track of books that I've read or want to read here in Sofa. And now the newest feature is you can even use this as your podcast player. Here's the full episodes of Primary Technology, a nice full-featured player here. You have quick access to show notes, formatted nicely, I might add. And with podcasts that support chapters, you can jump between them. And you even get that chapter artwork right here in Sofa. Whether you want to try it for a new podcast app or just use it for books, movies, and TV shows, I love Sofa, and using it on a larger screen like the iPad really makes it a nice experience. Number 10, if you wanted to transcribe audio on your iPad, there's a perfect app for that, and it's called Transcriptionist. This is actually made by the same developer as Ferrite, my podcast editing app. But here, I can choose an audio file from my Files app, like maybe a recent episode, load it into a new project here in Transcriptionist, tap the Transcribe button there, and it will start transcribing your audio automatically. Then you can export it into multiple formats, and you can even add multiple tracks if you have them synced up and you want to have different speakers here in Transcriptionist. Plus, Transcriptionist is also available for Mac and even the iPhone, so really powerful. Number 11, if you've ever been on a shoot and you need a teleprompter, there are lots of accessories for using the iPad as a teleprompter display, and my favorite app for that is Teleprompter Pro. Not only is there a Mac and iPhone app where you can sync between them, but you can even control the teleprompter here on iPad from your other devices, either running the teleprompter app, you can use Bluetooth devices, remotes, all kinds of accessories. Nicely designed, really flexible. I use this on my Mac and my iPad. Now for the musicians and vocalists out there, I've talked about it before, but if you ever want to use digital sheet music, forScore is the app to get. I absolutely love this app. It was one of the first apps I ever used on iPad, been using it ever since, and forScore is simply the best digital sheet music app out there. You can connect cloud storage and even services like Music Notes to import sheet music that you've bought, has a built-in metronome and tuner, even has a little piano you can bring up to play notes, and one of the craziest features, you can turn pages just by winking or moving your mouth. You do need a Face ID enabled iPad to do it, but it is an incredibly cool feature. Turn pages without touching the device, or if you want, you can also connect Bluetooth pedals to turn pages. That's actually what my wife does when she's practicing flute. Absolutely love forScore. Now, I have to actually mention a couple first party apps that are really powerful on the iPad. First one being Notes. With iOS 18, there's been a bunch of new features, including things like adding an audio file to a note and then getting a full transcription right here in Notes. And if you have Apple Intelligence on your iPad, you can even get a summary of the transcription from an audio file that you've attached to the note. That's cool. But Notes is also powerful with task lists, different things that you can attach, including recording a new voice memo, perfect for lectures. But Notes has also been updated in iOS 18 for math, calculations. You also get call recording synced. And using tags and folders, Notes can become really powerful. I actually did an entire video dedicated to Apple Notes and all the features that are hidden behind the scenes. You can check that video out, linked up here or down in the description. Another underrated first-party app is Keynote. I have built every slideshow I've used when I give a talk in Keynote for years. Plus, you can do all the shapes and effects, things like that. But if you didn't know, you can actually control your Keynote presentation from your iPad with other Apple devices. Then when you open a Keynote on your iPad, you can press play on something like your iPhone, and now you're controlling the presentation from your iPhone. You can connect your iPad to an external display, and you get that remote control all built in. And if you have Apple Intelligence on your iPad, Image Playground is now built into Keynote. So you can describe something, maybe like the pyramids of Egypt. You can generate images right here and then insert them into your slides in Keynote in just a few seconds. I didn't want to do the exact pyramids of Egypt, so gave me something generic. Number 15, I've talked about this app in so many videos, but Bear is my default note-taking app. It's also what I use here on iPad, but I also love it because I've written articles, blog posts, even small books right here in Bear. Easy access to Word and character count, plus you can export this in multiple formats, lots of different themes and templates for when you export, and you can even use Image Playground now right here in Bear as well. Number 16 is Procreate. Now, I'm not an artist by any means, but I've seen some incredible things made in Procreate for iPad. My cousin is actually on Instagram and draws lots of characters using Procreate on iPad, so you can follow that Instagram account. I'll link it below in the description. But obviously, it's a super powerful app for iPad, and if you do any kind of artwork or drawing, it's a must-have. Number 17, when I'm reading the news, I enjoy doing it on the iPad, especially the 11-inch I have here, and Reader is the way to go. This is where I load up all my RSS feeds, read the articles here, and then maybe share them for the show notes for primary technology, or maybe I want to load the full website here in Reader. Reader is great for all of that, plus it's also on the Mac and the iPhone, and it syncs really nicely. I use the built-in Reader iCloud Sync. Now, number 18, of course, I have to mention Shortcuts. When it comes to making the iPad a powerful device, Shortcuts is invaluable. I use tons of shortcuts on the iPad. I actually did an entire video on iPad shortcuts, including a clipboard manager built with shortcuts. I'll link that video above and down below as well. Number 19, if you like mind mapping or just kind of having a free form, which is another iPad app that probably should mention, but I've used MindNode more in the past. Again, whether you're trying to make diagrams, org charts, just brainstorming and connecting blocks, MindNode is a great app for that. Multiple color themes and looks. Makes it easy to connect certain ideas. Plus you can add photos, Image Playground, also available here in MindNode. And you can even collaborate with others on your MindNode documents. And finally, number 20, the Apple News app, but specifically the new Recipes feature. This is brand new in iPadOS 18.4, but recipes on the iPad just look beautiful. You get the ingredient list, the steps, and you can even go into cook mode, which now makes the text large. Great if it's on your kitchen counter. And every time you run into a timer during a recipe, you can just tap on it and start that timer right here on your iPad. It's actually a really nice implementation of recipes. You do have to be subscribed to Apple News Plus or have it in your Apple One Services bundle, but it's actually really nice here on iPad. Now, a couple honorable mentions that really should be in this list. I use Notion all the time on my iPad. Me and my co-host for Primary Tech collaborate on the show notes. And I'll use Notion, especially when I'm doing research or gathering articles from Reader. Canva is another great app for iPad to create social media imagery and graphics. And while I don't use it very often, Logic Pro on the iPad, it's actually a really powerful application, even closer to the desktop version than Final Cut. Lots of sounds, templates, and can really show off the power of things like the M4 chip in the iPad Pro. So those are my top 20 iPad apps of all time. Now, I'm sure I missed some, so let me know down in the comments which are some of your favorites or just really powerful apps that show off the iPad's capabilities. Links to the videos I talked about are down in the video description. I'd appreciate if you subscribe to the channel and hit that like button. More videos on the iPad and iPhone and all the Apple stuff coming soon. And if you want to see that video that goes in depth on Apple Notes, I'll put that right up here. Or if you want to see my older video of me editing podcasts on iPad in real time, it was actually a live stream, you can check it out right up here. Thanks for watching. I'll catch you next time.